He has given lectures and authored many articles on the UFO topic, including validating the new Majestic documents. The extraterrestrial hypothesis, it's not that bad. Spelling error, forensic linguistics, and alien viruses and leaked documents. He has personally handled and now possesses many leaked documents. Please help us welcome Dr. Robert Wood.
Thank you, audio-visual crew, and good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to another exciting day. I'm going to talk about one specific book, an encyclopedia of flying saucers, and it should be up on the screen. It is. And here's what I'm going to cover. I'm going to talk about nine things: how I became involved in this subject, the manuscript and its arrival, the author, Vernon Bowen, what the book says, the markings on the book, the forensic tests that we did and their results, some remarkable annotations that were written by hand while the Air Force had it all these years, question mark, a challenge for the audience as to figure out who Ben was, and then something about editing the book. Beginning with how I got started in this, and I'll tell you some things that I haven't really told a lot of people, and I'll just take that slide off for a moment and talk from the heart. It was in the late 60s when my boss got an assignment. I worked at McDonnell Douglas, and he had an assignment to talk on the occasion of the retirement of General Schriever about how we would be able to go to orbit and back 10 years hence. So he turned to me, I was his deputy, and said, "You got any ideas as to how we ought to do that?" And so just for a joke, I said, "Well, hey, Ray, why don't you tell him how the alleged UFOs do it?" And he said, "Hey, that's a great idea. Why don't you work on that?" So I read my first book by Don Menzel. And after I read that book, I said, "Wow, it seems to me this guy is not reporting on all the facts." So then I read another 50 books. And pretty soon, I was, by coincidence, in an opportunity to answer the question my bosses had, which is, anything exciting going on in your mind? And I said, "Well, yeah." I said, "I've read 50 UFO books, and you're not going to believe this, but the fact of the matter is that they clearly come from somewhere else. There's people on board, and they know how to control gravity." I said, "The only thing that's a question is whether we learn how to control gravity before or after Lockheed." And so the net result of that was that they said, "Well, you know, why don't you take a couple guys and think about this?" So for 2.5 years, we had about, actually it turned out to be more than a couple guys, we had about 5 guys, one of whom was Stan Friedman, who was hired specifically to read all the UFO literature and then see if that literature gave us some clues as to how to build them. So we had this project that went on, and finally, we knew we were spending money at a finite rate, but we didn't know how quickly we were getting to any answers, so we canceled the project. And then I had another 30 years before I could retire in 1993 or so. And in that time, I was responsible for doing ballistic missile defense and wound up involved with a CIA contract looking at the Soviet ballistic missile defense, and then and was involved in applying advanced technology to the space station, and I ran the McDonnell Douglas IRAD program for 10 years, and so I did all these other things, always poised, ready, waiting to go to tackle the most important thing that I knew was out there, namely, how do they work, and how can we make the world a better place as a result of understanding this technology. So when I retired in 1993, you'd expect my now good friend, Stan Friedman, who had incidentally honored our request to not reveal that he'd worked for McDonnell Douglas on this subject. All these years, he honored that request. But Stan called me up, and you know how when you retire, why everybody assumes you don't have anything to do? So he called me up and said, "I know you don't have anything to do, so I got something that's a challenge." He said, "There's a guy, Don Berliner, who's received this classified document in the mail, and it seems like a manual for how to recover crashed UFOs." He said, "It might be authentic." I said, "Are you willing to take a look at it?" So I wound up running the best copies I could with Don, and that wound up being Special Operations Manual, which is available in the back, Extraterrestrial Entities and Technology Recovery and Disposal. Basically, a manual to our personnel as to how to recover the craft and how to keep the public in the dark. Well, anyway, so this went on, and it turned out that I was beginning to be interested in talking to UFO groups, and so Ryan and I gave a presentation in Connecticut in the mid-90s. And as a result of Linda Moulton Howe's enthusiasm for what we were saying about the authenticity of this document, why got some people who wanted to pay us money to authenticate the documents, and so we wound up getting $500,000 for that purpose, thereby proving that it's false, that you can't make money in the business. Actually, this was very lucky. We're probably the only people who've made a ton of money that way. But in any case, I'm leading up to the next point, which is going to get back to the book, and that is, during this time, Stan Friedman, who was now kind of happy that we made some progress, said, you know, here I am in Canada, and here you are in Southern California. There's a guy who's been writing to me all these years saying he's got some documents that people are leaking to him. His name is Timothy Cooper. He lives in Big Bear Lake. Why don't you go up and see him? So I did. One day I went up and met this guy, and sure enough, he had a lot of documents that people had leaked to him. And so we had a relationship, and I began to copy those documents and try to authenticate them. And then one day in June of 1999, he called me up and said, I got this document in the mail. It's a 335-page manuscript. And now this slide here tells you and summarizes what I just said, how we got to June of 1999 and all of my personal involvement. So, at that point in time, here's a summary of all the sources that have provided documents that I've been studying. And the one that's in red is the one that came from Fort Meade Freedom of Information Office to Timothy Cooper and included this manuscript written by Vernon Bowen. I'm not going to talk about all of the others because that's kind of another talk. I'm going to focus just on this one document and what it says and why it's important to the subject we're all interested in, which ultimately is crashed and shot down flying saucers. The manuscript arrived, and it came in a sealed Jiffy mailer. This is the actual mailer. You know, people who are skeptics say, well, where's the originals? Well, here's the original. This is, I got upside down. Right now you can see it. So that's what it came in. It was received, and he wrote right on it, received 6699. The return address was Fort Meade, and the pages were double-spaced usually and single-sided. So on the envelope, this is what it says. It was a typewriter. It was used to make his address, and then there was a stamp for Freedom of Information and Privacy Office, U.S. Army Intelligence and Security Command from Fort Meade, Maryland. And it's interesting, and I'll tell you later, that the manuscript had originally been given to the Air Force, but it came back from the Army. So we'll do a summary of this manuscript and where it went and when in a moment. Now, when you get something from the Freedom of Information, as a result of Freedom of Information Act, from an archive, you have to ask yourself, well, what are the factors that caused the archivist to send it to me? And you know, there must be people, if in fact there were a program of deception, as we heard about last night, there would be people in the archives trying to make sure that the archivist did not inadvertently send out information that should not be sent out. And so there's always somebody at work thinking about what should come back, and we don't really know who they are. Now, we'll move to the contents. They were 330 pages. Some of them are fragile. And here is the first page, right here, the original page. For those of you who want to see an original document that has the original stamp of top secret magic on it, this is one of the two that exist in the world, as far as I know. The clippings were falling off. They were numbered on the upper right, either in green or black, by Vernon Bowen. I'll tell you about him in just a moment. The text was double-spaced. The clippings were single-spaced. The red security markings had been added. There were annotations added, and that's pretty key. And there was no cover letter. Now, the reason that there's no cover letter, I will comment on, and that is Timothy Cooper had been requesting documents from 12 different agencies since the early 90s. And in fact, his original interest was in the JFK assassination. But after he talked to his father, who incidentally received a commendation from Curtis LeMay, thanking him for his work on UFO gun camera and the UFO project of the Air Force. Incidentally, I don't think anybody has ever seen anything from the Air Force that ever admitted that they had a UFO project that included gun camera photographs. This is a documented writing that his father received. So anyway, he and his father clearly told him some things about UFOs that interested Timothy. And so Timothy had flooded 12 agencies with requests for Freedom of Information Act stuff. So they all knew that here's this guy out there who wants something. And presumably that's the reason that the Fort Meade office sent him something, and that was to sort of satisfy him. But they didn't send the cover letter. And maybe one of the reasons they didn't send the cover letter is because there were three or four pages that were not included. We'll come back to that. There's the title page. I just held it up. And in the upper left there, it says it was submitted to Blue Book in 1954, and that's crossed out, and then it says 1960. And I think this actually was not submitted in 54. It was submitted in 60, and that was just a confusion on the part of the Air Force person trying to make records. He wrote children's books. There's an obvious red stamp I'll talk about in a little bit. And there are three addresses that are shown there. The last one is Old Greenwich, Connecticut. And so obviously I wanted to find out more about the author. For example, he might still have been alive. So in the preface material that had been written by the author, he described a little bit about his background in anticipation of giving this to the Air Force. And so he explained that he was a deacon in a particular church, and which the church was. So I picked up the phone, called the church's office, and they said, oh yeah, Vernon Bowen, he's a great guy. He died a long time ago, but he has a son, Pat Bowen. Do you want his number? So I said, sure. So in just a matter of a few minutes, I was on the phone with Pat Bowen. But I'll tell you first about his father, Vernon Bowen, the author of the book. In fact, I just told you what is on this slide here, except for the fact that Pat did confirm that it was his father who had done this. He remembered his dad talking about writing a book on UFOs. Or flying saucers, excuse me. And as a matter of fact, since I made that mistake just now, I'll explain that in 1947, as you probably know, the words or the phrase flying saucers was used by the media on the occasion of Kenneth Arnold's sighting. And that phrase stuck. And then about late 53 or so, after the CIA review, someone decided to start talking about unidentified flying objects, and they abbreviated that UFOB, UFOB. And so for about 1 year, the official Air Force designation was UFOB, but apparently the media found that was too much to deal with, and so they shortened it to UFOs. And so in 54 or so, the words became UFO, 54, 55. But Vernon Bowen, when he wrote this book, never once used the word UFO. He always used the word flying saucer. And so his son, Pat Bowen, had never seen this manuscript, even though he did know the typewriter, and he said that he had more files. And so I was excited to find out more about the origin of the manuscript. Now, the manuscript itself included this little discussion by Vernon himself, because he anticipated, you know, giving this to the Air Force. So he wanted to tell him a little bit about his background. And he claimed he was an ad man in New York City. Now, Patrick Bowen, his son, tells me that, no, he regarded him as a writer. But actually, I think he got his income from being an advertising agency guy. He often went to the public library in New York City, and it seemed to me like he'd copied everything that was ever written in anything you could find from the Periodical Guide to Literature up till 1954. And he was a good writer. He'd written five children's books and had a couple of other books, and his son today tells me that he had other manuscripts that he surprised that he never sent in. And he was well connected, though, and I was really kind of impressed with the list of people he knew personally. A personal assistant to John Rockefeller, John Mueller, the CEO, retired CEO of RCA Communications, George Romney, even I remembered that name because the president of American Motors. Irvine was the president of Marietta College, where Pat had graduated, the son. And Cleworth, president of Cleworth Publishing. Sam Ballard was the president of Guyer, Maury, Mattern, and Ballard, which is the company that Vernon Bowen worked for. And then he apparently knew on a first-name basis, the publisher of Look magazine, which Vernon Myers. So he was pretty well connected. And he was a very loyal American. I'll come to that a little bit later. So now I want to tell you a little bit about what the book says. The book is available later in this format, and I'll explain to you how it got to that format. But right now, there are 15 chapters, and these are the 15 chapters. And what I'll do is take a few moments so there's no mystery about what's in the book and give you a simple summary of what the chapters are all about. The first chapter is the one that deals with what are flying saucers. And then finally he concludes briefly after a couple pages by offering 30 different choices, very creative actually, for what they might be. And then he brings it back to 1947 and talks about in the late 40s all the different shapes that were seen, what the numerous reports are. He brings in Mantell's death where he was chasing a flying saucer. But he emphasizes that flying saucers and reports of strange people are not new. They've been going on for a long time. So he jumps then into another chapter talking about the history, the heart of the mystery, going back to 222 BC, where there are a number of reports of ships coming from nowhere and dropping things, or in some cases, abducting people. And all of this is reminiscent of Charles Fort, who wrote four books called The Book of the Damned, New Lands, Low, and Wild Talents. And there was even a Fortean society of people who felt it was important to study these anomalistic reports. Here's a fish saying, "They hauled me into a strange vessel, removed the hook, and took photographs and measurements, and then I blacked out. When I awoke, I was back in the lake, and they were gone." Yeah, right. So you never really know what's going on. And Charles Fort was a master of leaving you with that kind of mystery with his books. So he was the first guy to suggest in writing that all these strange craft appearing over the centuries possibly were extraterrestrial. And then he takes that and he goes that and reports on a nice chapter on the evidence of legend about the folk tales from Hawaii, Canadian Indians, the Hindus, how there was an extensive discussion of advanced technology in the history of man, the Greeks, the Irish, the Bible. He talks about giants in history and even dwarfs in history, because little people that come out of the ground, and the Menehunes in particular in Hawaii and the island of Kauai. So he brings in a lot of things that some of you have heard of and others of you probably haven't. But then, in order to make sure that we have the right focus, he brings in what we did back in the late 40s. We said, well, couldn't they have been misperceptions of other things, like, you know, normal natural lights, which is, of course, what Don Menzel argued was the case. And he talks about Will-O-the-Wisp, Mount Brown Mountain Lights, and Foo Fighters, and then the fireballs of the Southwest. So with that in the background, then he starts to lay on the audience the actual sightings with using lots of sources, magazines, books, newspapers. Whatever was a sighting, he puts in from 1808 through 54. And then having done that with respect to sightings, here was a guy who had figured it out that there was a sighting and then there was a close encounter. Then actually he has the next chapter is about what the literature says about the whole subjects, but includes the close encounters. And so that ends in 1954. And because clearly the question is, well, what's the proof of all this? He provides a chapter that has photographs. And unfortunately, when the manuscript came back from the Air Force, there were no photographs. That's not surprising, but there were two things that were missing when it came back, in my judgment. One is there were about 6 pages that were missing, and the other is that all the photographs were missing. But one of the references to the photographs has a little note that's right here, that this note I'll talk about later, but it's a note that's signed Ben, and he's talking about initially about the photographs, but what he says later is highly instructive with respect to the existence of a covert program. So then from there he goes to the landings, obviously the photographs, and then the landings. He confirms the 1947 cases in New Mexico and the 1950 Texas-Mexican border incident, which incidentally is included in the Eisenhower briefing document, as some of you may know. A Brush Creek example and Adamski, and then the he mentions the contactees of that era of the 50s, which are Adamski. Besides Adamski, Betherum, Angelucci, Van Tassel, Don Fry, those people he covers as being present reporting, having taken rides. And so the next chapter is, he asks the question, well, why aren't there more landings? And here he interestingly speculates, and really state of the art, because this was the year when the idea of antimatter first came out by Gamow and Dirac, had a theory that they called reversed matter. But shortly after that, it was called antimatter. So this was the exact year when reverse matter was suggested by the scientific community. And he suggested, well, maybe because the Siberian explosion of 1908 might have been antimatter, that's why there aren't more interactions, because they're made of the antimatter. Then he jumps into the question of the Air Force. Now, I would emphasize that Vernon Bowen clearly was a very, very patriotic American. Because as he wrote about the Air Force, he described them from the point of view of the problems they had in dealing with the public and the issues that they were facing, quite independent of whether or not the flying saucers were real craft or whether they weren't. And he did that actually very objectively. But he leaned over in the direction of being good to the Air Force instead of being critical. And it's interesting, you can see in some of the things that were deleted or comments by the Air Force that's the case. But he did point out in conclusion, though, that possibly the cover-up, which pretty clearly existed even at that time, that it could be a cover-up of the Air Force's own ignorance, that they didn't know where they were from, how they were here, and we couldn't control our own airspace. I love this cartoon. It says, I assure you, madam, if any such creatures as you describe really existed, we would be the first to know about it. And of course, that's the alien on the telephone. And the Air Force is locked up. So you don't really ever know who's in charge. And so going on, then we have the last 3 chapters where, with a great deal of objectivity, he talks about the hoaxers and what is the will of the public to believe in this? Is that a factor? Could the hoaxers, you know, pull on that? How would you? And he begins to think about how, if you wanted to do a counterintelligence program, how would you do that? And actually, he's very insightful in that regard. And then he talks about what he calls the other side of the coin. And this is a straightforward statement that, hey, they're all Soviets. The Soviets are way, way, way ahead of us. They have been all along, and we just got caught with our pants down, and these guys know how to do it, and we're probably doomed if that's the case, because the commies and the Reds are at us. Now, here's a guy, it's written in this time, he was so pro-American that he even talked about commies. You know, it's a long time since we've heard about commies, but very, very American guy, very patriotic. He certainly would have belonged to an exchange club if they existed at the time. But his conclusion was, well, what are they? And then he very subtly, he leaves you with a statement. He says, I think that they're ours, or will be. In other words, he implied, but never stated, that if we captured them, we'd do the reverse engineering and figure out how they work. So this guy is kind of a fun writer, and he's good. He's not a page turner, but it's kind of a chapter turner, and it's a fun book. Well, here's a cartoon that I thought was relevant. Here's the Blondie cartoon. Dagwood goes up and says, reads this magazine, says, cat abducted by space aliens, Bigfoot sighted. He says, who reads this trash? And the guy says, over 20 million readers. And so later, Bondi comes and said, Dagwood, would you take out the trash? I haven't finished reading it yet. And you remember that Terry Hansen specifically told us yesterday that CIA employees were highly involved in controlling some of the stories in the National Enquirer. And I have to apologize to both Terry and the Enquirer for misspelling the name Enquirer. It's with an E, I believe. Isn't that right, Terry? Yeah, that's right. So let's talk now about some of the more exciting aspects, although that's pretty exciting, on the return book. And here's one of the pages. These are the pages that have been pasted on. Clearly what he did is he typed these things as he got them, and then to put them in chronological order, he cut them out and just pasted them on with the glue. Well, the glue was about 38 years old by the time I got it, and so these were falling off, and so we put the book together, we just put everything in order, because that was his intent. The stamp on the first page states right here, the highest classification for this document is top secret / magic, no foreign dissemination, for U.S. eyes only, and exempt from declassification, errata. And I didn't know what errata was until yesterday morning when I was having lunch with one of you, and breakfast with one of you. And he suggested it might be originating agency declassification authority, which would make a lot of sense, because the authority for classifying this is very unclear. And they also wanted to make sure it never got declassified. And special handling required, not releasable to foreign nationals. These are all conventional statements. The caveats, which is what the word you use to describe these stamps, were all in red ink, and the title page was stamped as you just saw, but most of the pages were stamped only confidential until you got to the one on the Air Force, which was stamped top secret magic. And there were a lot of pen notations, and we'll talk about those in just a moment. Here is an example of some of the pen notations at the top. It says Blue Book files, and then later it says written in 1954, maybe should never be used, if so should be brought up to date. Now this is actually Vernon Bowen writing to himself about the final publication, final manuscript. But after he wrote this and before it was published, he gave the whole package to the Air Force for their review and approval, because he didn't want to be inadvertently publishing something that was classified. But you can see with all these inks that you can do some dating. I would call your attention especially to the blue original stamp there on the right. If you go to the archives, you can find exemplars of this blue original stamp. And it's very clear that this is a legitimate, regular use of a stamp that's used by the government to indicate that this is an original document. And so that, in effect, further enhances its authenticity. So now let's talk about the forensic testing. One of the difficulties that you have with accepting the authenticity of the 4,000 pages of leaked documents that I have and 100 documents or so, is because in some cases all I have is a Xerox copy. And if you can show that the Xerox copy was made at an earlier date based on other things, then that's helpful to enhance the authenticity. But the counter argument always comes back is, where's the original? What's the provenance of this document you have? So when you have an original, if you're a document authenticator, why, you're very excited, because this is the time that you can do the watermark, you can date the paper, you can date the ink. And so this is one of only two documents, as far as I know, that exist in the world, well, that exist in the world that's not classified, okay, where it says top secret magic in ink. And so that leads to the question of what kind of forensic testing can you do? And I hired Specking Forensic Laboratories to do thin layer chromatography, or TLC, on the inks. This will permit them to take a sample of ink, about a 1 millimeter diameter sample punched out of the paper, and then they dissolve that in a fluid, and then as a result of various diffusion effects, compare that with the exemplars of different manufacturers' inks, one at a time, just like a library. And they'll tell you which manufacturer made which ink. You can do the pencil to less precisely, but you can do watermark comparison. And they couldn't get a match on watermark. But I have a guy more local to me whose name is James Black, and he's a typewriter expert. He has typewriter exemplars going all the way back to the early 30s. And so you can take an original document and take it to him, and he will tell you after some time that, yeah, this is a 1939 Underwood typewriter. And in fact, that's what it is. And he also watermarked the paper as a New York watermark source. And this is the letter that he wrote to me. That is the evidence that I have that it was authenticated by an official person. And this is a magnification of the portion of the letter that describes his authentication statement. And they go back to the results from Specken. Ribbon was consistent with the era. Pencils are from the 50s. The red stamp ink is not recent, and the felt tip ink is not recent either. But we'll talk about the details of that ink. And here again is an enlargement of the ballpoint ink analysis from Specken. Now, the post 1977 ballpoint ink was one of the three or so inks. One of them is Ben's note. One of them is submitted to Project Blue Book. One of them is the New Mexico 1947 cases, and one of them is the Kilgallen Comets. Now, those you don't know about yet because we haven't got there, but that's just a summary of where the inks were. The 1961 ballpoint ink was always used by Vernon Bowen. So we know now that Vernon was writing on this manuscript up until sometime in 1961, because he bought the pen from Bic in 1961. And the things that he wrote were just kind of notes to himself in some cases. And this third one, for example, is a semi-official recognition of the extraterrestrial theory, Captain E.J. Ruppelt. He had just added Ruppelt as an additional reference, because he was a kind of a complete guy and he liked to reference things accurately. And there were pencil notations. There was only one pencil notation in the book, and this one is, I hope DM keeps his big mouth shut. DM is alluding to Don Menzel, who, as some of you, probably most of you know, was one of the original MJ-12 persons that were identified as part of the magic program. This is a magnification that showed the little tiny holes. You see in the W and the R that there are little holes in there at the top. That, see here. Oops. I'm looking for my pointer. I guess I don't have a pointer. But anyway, you can see the little dots in the handwriting ink there in the word written. So those dots are what you use to analyze the date. So in summary then, the ballpoint was certainly Bowen. The felt tip was early government assessment, and the 1977 ballpoint was the remarks by Ben, New Mexico, 47 cases, and the extensive underlining. In many cases, the persons who were reading this took out their pen, underlined something they thought was significant and related to the government program. And so by looking at the underlines, that in effect is a confirmation that Vernon Boeing was hitting it right on the nose. So let's talk about those annotations. And here we have an example of the 1977 Inc. at the top, submitted the Project Blue Book in 1954. And that's an actually incorrect statement. It was submitted apparently in 1961, but is unclassified and unevaluated, but it was written in 1977. Here again, we have his own comments, but this was interesting with a VB there on the right with a C around it. That is the way you'd say it's copyrighted. So this is the only place in the document that Vernon Boeing has claimed that he's copyrighted the material. And this was relevant to my subsequent conversations with Pat Boeing, who Pat immediately said, by the way, you know, since he's an attorney, he said, by the way, you know, the copyright of this book belongs to me. And so after some discussion, I wound up agreeing with him. And I checked with my own copyright guy, and he says, yeah, that's true. So this is not my book. It's merely, I'm the publisher of the book, and I'm the editor of the book, but Vernon Boeing is the author of the book. Here's a really interesting example. It relates to what Nick Redfern may talk about tomorrow. And here he's talking about species of super insects that build machines like man. He was alluding to Gerald Hurd's possibility that there were bees inside because they would be able to withstand the G's. And you could spin tall tales of moon dust, accuse the Air Force of covering up the greatest stories in Christ. And here he's identified moon dust and said Project Moondust off on the left. Well, that certainly suggests there might have been a Project Moondust. This page is the one that begins the visual proof section. It has, again, the blue original stamp. And on the left there, it says, do not withdraw from files personal notes of Colonel Hayward. Okay, now, if I could get Michael Swords interested in this to go back and check into our knowledge of the Blue Book program, to see whether there was a Hayward or whether he was in counterintelligence or something like that, that could be very helpful. It also says that it comes from the file of ATIC, the UFO section. Now, clearly there was one reviewer knew about the Twining report, because here he's talking about secret aircraft, guided missiles, pulsing phenomena, continued reports. He has a note on the side, Twining's 92347 secret report to the Chief of Staff of the Air Force. And there was a secret report on the 23rd. On the 24th, there was a top secret report called the White Hot Report, and we have a copy of that from, source was Timothy Cooper, and one of the leakers. Okay, now, I want to clarify the context of this. This is in the section that's dealing with photographs. And at the bottom, you see a notation that says wrong, 001 has the prints. But the context of that comment is the following. It says, Ray Palmer, writing in his book on which he collaborated with Kenneth Arnold, said the original prints of the photograph published in newspapers are practically impossible to obtain. The newspapers have forgotten the addresses of photographers who took them. It doesn't make any difference. And the commentator in the Air Force says, wrong, 001 has the prints. Well, presumably, that's MJ-1, the first member of MJ-12, which would have been the head of the CIA. And another part says, and again, in her column Broadway Bulletin Award, Miss Kilgallen stated that a Harvard professor is telling his classes that he can prove that there are people on other planets. And one reviewer says, it's a highly dubious source of information, which is probably true. But another reviewer says, what is DM doing? And going back again to Don Menzel, says, Vernon Boeing is writing the following. He says, is it possible that all these people are counter-espionage agents for the government. He says, such reasoning might lead to the making of another question. Are Major Kehoe, Ray Palmer, Kenneth Arnold, George Adamski, Harold Wilkinson, Don Menzel, Frank Scully, all other writers on the subject of saucers, are they all counter-espionage agents for the U.S. government? And the comment is, I hope DM keeps his big mouth shut. And that's one of the remarks in pencil. So clearly, you know, this additional confirmation of the fact that Don Menzel was one of the original Majestic 12 people. And this merely shows the actual words on the page and the notations and the manuscripts as it was that I've been just reading to you. So now we'll talk about Ben. In the section, and this is a page right here, that is the end of the section on the photographs, where he has a comment talking about the quality of the comparison of the photograph that was taken by Paul Trent in Oregon with one that was taken in Italy. Now, actually, there's another one that was taken in France in 54 that also compares very nicely in the shape. So anyway, Vernon Bowen was talking about the relative quality of the comparison of these two or three different shapes. And one of the reviewers decided to make a note here, obviously to some other reviewer of this classified document. And I'm going to read you the details of the note instead of trying to do it right there, summarize it. But after you compare the Trent photos with the other photograph by Giuseppe Grasso, which is what Vernon Bowen was saying in that text, the manuscript note says, quote, good comparisons. Photos were analyzed at NPIC, which is National Photographic Interpretation Center, and show similar characteristics to those seen in NM, New Mexico. Photos in the white hot folder, not available as they are TS restricted data. AS2 requires a letter of authority before removing. Must have Majestic review before visiting Blue Room facility. Suggest you call Nate for appointment, Nate being Nathaniel Twining, for appointment to WP being Wright Patterson. Would also recommend prior approval from Van being General Vandenberg, before you make official inquiries. Wish I could be of more help to you in your follow-up investigation, Ben. P.S., I'll be at ADC, Air Development Center, for a while. Why don't you visit and we'll show you around. Well, now here's a note that's written to by a high-ranking officer who's calling all these guys, these generals by their first names, clearly talking to another guy who would be responsive to understanding people of that stature being called by their first names. So the obvious question is, who's Ben? Well, I thought for a while it was Ben Chidlaw, but it turns out that Ben Chidlaw died in 1977, and that was the date of the pen. So my guess is that it's very unlikely that Ben Chidlaw was the author of that. But in addition to that, I wrote to his daughter, who married another general, and asked for a sample of her father's writing. And she responded before the attorneys got involved. And so I have a sample of Ben Chidlaw's writing, and it doesn't match at all. He was a kind of a backhand writer, and he was printing half the time, and this is clearly a script. So I'm looking for Ben. Don't know who Ben is, and I'm eager to have any one of you come up and tell me, oh, you remember there was a Ben who was a general back then who was just maybe the right guy. So I'd love to be able to find Ben's handwriting in the archives and compare it with this handwriting, and then we'd have it stone cold. That would be wonderful. So let me conclude then by talking a little bit about the manuscript itself. Well, when I got all these 335 pages, the question is, well, in the first place, I did not, even though the intellectual property might have belonged to Patrick Bowen, I did not send him a complete copy of this because I thought there was an issue there. So I had physical ownership of this document, and he had intellectual ownership of the document, but they're not together yet. So I hired a transcription service so that I could get electronic ownership of the document, which is, of course, the only important thing. And I retained the paragraphing and corrected a few spelling errors that had been made by Vernon Bowen, who was usually a superior speller. There were a couple of editorial corrections, very minor, and I took out all the security caveats and didn't require line-for-line replication. But once it was done by the transcription service, I proofread every single word twice and made sure that it was exactly the way that Vernon Bowen would have wanted it to be appearing. So I pretended that I was Vernon trying to do the job he would have done. And that's the role of an editor. So we published the book, which arrived yesterday, and we printed 205 copies of this book. So they're available, actually not for $20, we're selling them for $15 at this conference. So that's why you should come to this conference. And actually, I think it's a really, really fun read. So, and it's exciting from the point of view of the authentication of the existence of the MJ-12 program, which of course deals in principle and primarily with the crash retrieval process. So it doesn't report an actual crash, but it comes very close to being one of two original documents with top secret magic in red ink that clearly is authentic. And so that's what we have, and that's what I've shared with you today, and I'm ready for questions. Yes, sir.
I don't know how, I forget who talked about it on the poster post. A lot of these crashes we get by shooting UFOs down, they say as early as the 1920s, we lost thousands of aircraft. That includes around the world.
Okay.
Would this be involved with that? What you're talking about?
The comment he made was that it's possible that we have shot down aircraft for a long time. I've never been exposed to a report that said as early as the 20s, but it's certainly true that the evidence is overwhelming that we have, we began to move into the mode of shooting them down, certainly in the 50s and 60s, and I have contacts in the Soviet Union who tell me that they did exactly the same thing until they lost so many pilots that they decided not to do that. I'm satisfied that there's a reasonable possibility that the famous Roswell crash was the result of actually our weaponry. We were working on proximity fused anti-aircraft shells at that time. And I can easily imagine somebody telling the guy who was running the White Sands base where they were testing these. To go ahead and shoot them down. And it's clear that we wanted to get these craft in our possession. When the first ones crashed, Cape Girardeau in 1941, and then the two that came down as a result of the Battle of L.A. 1942, one crashed in the San Bernardino Mountains and one salvaged by the Navy at sea. Those things are not very well known unless you've been coming to this conference. But No. I can tell you everything I know about the documents that I read, and I tend to talk about that primarily. So I don't know that anybody has ever claimed that they know for sure where those two particular craft came from. Other question? Yes, sir, over here.
Since there was a return address, did you try to contact Fort Meade and the Counterintelligence Freedom of Information? Because you said there was a return address. You received that document, and there was that address at Fort Meade.
No, I did not follow up on that address. That address at Fort Meade was, well, let's see, I did follow up to an extent. I talked to someone whose name I won't mention right here, who told me confidentially that he had worked for that particular agency with that particular address, and it was Army Counterintelligence. So he confirmed that it was the right address, and that's what they did in that place. So yeah, I got a personal report from someone who would be known to many people in this audience, but I won't tell you who it is. Yes, sir.
I don't know if this works, but concerning Timothy Cooper, did I hear you say that he himself had been making FOIA requests of various agencies over the years?
Yes.
Okay. And you also have maintained that he has been leaked a number of documents.
Yes.
Did this leakage occur as a result of his FOIA requests, or is that separate and distinct from his FOIA activities?
The answer is two of the leaks came from as a result of his FOIA request, two of his responses. But most of them came from people that he just knew. And this chart answers your question. It shows that about halfway in the middle, it says Tim Cooper FOIA. That's one of the MJ-12 documents. This was a document that was one page of 500 pages that was responsive to an FOI request, had Majestic 12 on it. And the other one was the one that I'm talking about, the FOIA. The other seven came from people who leaked them to him. One put it in a mailbox, one gave them to him personally at American Legion home, one put them in a mailbox, and the other four came to him in the mail from four different locations. One of them was a CIA post office box. So I think that answered the question.
Dr. Wood, would you mind bringing up that slide with the comments from Ben on it? Because I think I have an idea who that might be.
Oh, wow. Okay. All right. Okay, you want the one that shows the comments? Or the
That's
one?
Correct.
Okay. Okay, here's the one that shows the comments, but the one where you can read is this one.
This is fine.
Okay.
I would suggest that the Ben that has made this note might be Ben Rich, who is the head of the Lockheed Skunk Works. And given the fact that he said he would be at the Air Development Center for a while, that very well may be who it is, because obviously he has top secret clearances and knew all the generals because of all the aircraft he developed. So I would suggest you look at that as his handwriting should be readily available.
That's the best question I've ever had in the last 10 years. Thank you very much. I'm excited. I'm going to find a copy of Ben Rich's handwriting. Thank you. Other questions? Yes.
I'm confused about this 1977 ballpoint dating,
yeah,
because when I look at that document, I do think Benjamin Chidlaw, and I'm thinking Nathan Twining and Hoyt Vandenberg, but Vandenberg was dead before 1960. So how could you get a 1977 piece of writing that's referring to Vandenberg? It doesn't make any sense to me. I don't know what I'm missing. Could there be a mistake in the dating of the ballpoint ink?
Who are you saying died in 1960?
Vandenberg. Vandenberg didn't make it into the 60s. He died.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
So I just don't see how you could have
someone... Well, you're saying, okay, all it says is...
I mean, it would have to be a different Van and a different
name. It could
be
a different Vandenberg. Could be a different Van. It could be a different Van. Yeah, so that's an interesting point.
But when you think Van and Nate, I mean, it seems reasonable to think it might be Vandenberg and Nathan Twining, right? But
yeah,
but it couldn't be them if it's a 1977.
Well, what I seem to know for sure is that it is 1977, and we know what the words say. So if we follow up on this gentleman's suggestion that it might have been Ben Rich, then that may sort out who Van is. But if you're certain that Vandenberg was dead by then you're right. That's the problem.
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you very much for that. You got two good suggestions.
I have a question. I've had the opportunity to meet Tim Cooper and was recently with Timothy Good in England and was surprised to hear that Timothy Good is very skeptical about Tim Cooper as a source and feels that he's not been open and above board in all the things having to do with these documents and may have been responsible for creating some of them. Yeah. I didn't get that impression when I was with Tim Cooper, but I wondered if you could address the problem and why you think Timothy Good makes this attack.
Yeah, that's a good question. It's certainly true that Timothy Good does not feel that Tim Cooper is exactly everything he says he is. And the reason for that, in my opinion, is overwhelmingly related to one letter that Timothy Cooper had written to Tim Good early on, asking whether Tim Good would be interested in seeing the documents that he had received. Well, that particular letter turned out to have been written on a typewriter that was very similar to, if not identical to, the typewriter that has one of the documents. Now, I had my forensic analyst look at it, and he concluded that there was nothing there that would prove that it was the same typewriter, but there was nothing that would disprove that it might have been, you know, the same brand. So I believe that Tim Good has overreacted to the remote possibility that it was the same typewriter for this letter, and has totally ignored all of the overwhelming evidence that you'd have. If anybody spends a little time with Tim Cooper, you'll see he's a straightforward kind of guy. I mean, each of us has something in our personalities that make us a little different. And all you have to do is spend some time with this guy to know that he's the real thing. Incidentally enough, is no longer really interested in the subject. He's gone on to other issues, focusing on religious aspects. Any other questions? Yes.
This may be an ill-informed question because I don't know when this man died, but why wouldn't Van be Vannevar Bush, Dr. Vannevar Bush?
Oh. Oh, that's a very interesting suggestion. Yeah. I'll check on that too. Yeah. The question was, why couldn't Van have been Vannevar Bush? And that's a good suggestion. If I knew when Vannevar Bush died, then that would possibly be good. So you guys have given me some research that I have to do, and I'll report back to you somehow. But the answer is...